All right. Hello, everyone. We're just going to let people kind of come into the webinar with us. I want to welcome you and introduce myself before we officially start it off. My name is Maya, and I'm a recruitment coordinator here at the University of New England. You may recognize my name from a variety of emails that you get. And I'm so excited that you're all joining us this evening. Just as a reminder, this webinar is being recorded. So whether you're joining us live right now or watching it back, hello and welcome. Today, I'm super excited to be joined by some of my colleagues in the Office of Graduate Admissions, as well as some of UNE's DPT faculty, to go over some exciting curriculum changes and updates involving our DPT program and the innovative changes that are coming to you as a prospective student. So, before we officially kick off the presentation, let's just go around the virtual room and do some introductions. Like I said, my name is Maya, and I'm going to go ahead and pass it off to my colleague Elise.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Maya. My name is Elise Murphy, and I'm the Associate Director of Graduate Recruitment here at UNE. We're thrilled to have you join us tonight, or like Maya said, if you're watching the recording later, thank you so much for your interest in UNE and our PT program. I'm excited to learn about some of the changes tonight. So, I won't spend a whole lot of time talking, but we're looking forward to an engaging event with you this evening. Alicia, do you want to introduce yourself next?
Hi everyone. My name is Alicia. I'm the admissions coordinator for the DPT program. So you'll see my contact information later in the presentation, but you're going to hear from me a lot throughout the application cycle, and I'll be your point of contact for any questions you have.
Sally, do you want to go ahead and introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi everybody, and welcome to this webinar. We're so delighted that you wanted to join us. My name is Sally McCormick-Tutt. I'm the program director for the physical therapy program. I've been at UNE for quite a while, 18 years, and love everything about it, but I'm really excited to share some of the changes that we're making that we know will make this curriculum even stronger than it already is. So I'll turn it over to my assistant program director and colleague, Mike Lawrence.
I think you did my introduction for me. So I'm Mike Lawrence. I'm on faculty. My area is in, especially is kinesiology, biomechanics, and anatomy in the program.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Before, again, we officially kick off the presentation, just want to remind everyone that this is being recorded. And additionally, throughout the presentation, if any questions arise, please feel free to use the Q&A function. We'll have an entire time allotted at the end of this kind of session to answer any questions that you may have, as well as go through some of the questions that we ourselves have for the program. So let's just go ahead and get started with our presentation. Elise, if you don't mind sharing your screen. Awesome, thank you so much. So just a little bit about today's session. We're gonna learn about our DPT program and the exciting curriculum updates we have, as well as a little bit about the application process, just some important dates and reminders regarding that. And then, like I said, at the very end, we'll go over a Q&A. So my section to this presentation is just to give you a few quick facts about the University of New England itself. And we're proud to say that we are the number one provider for health professionals in Maine. And if you didn't know, we're located in Portland, Maine, and our Portland campus is specifically dedicated to so many graduate health programs, including PT, dental medicine, nurse anesthesia, osteopathic medicine, occupational therapy, and so many more. So this just kind of highlights and is an example of our dedication to the health professions and our dedication to healthcare collaboration and education. So We actually have two campuses in Maine, one in Portland and one in Biddeford, which is about 20 minutes south from Portland. As a DPT student, you'll be primarily in person on the Portland campus while you aren't out on clinical experiences. Like I said, this is a graduate-focused campus, so you have so many resources available to you as a graduate student here, including library services, student health services, counseling services, and just so many more. So this is just a little example of kind of what awaits you right along the coast and campus that is dedicated to your success as a graduate student. So let's go ahead and kick it off to the program. And yeah.
All right. So here's our section of this presentation to just talk about the curriculum. I think it's kind of exciting to see this first slide and realize that we have been a DPT, well, a PT program. We've transitioned from the bachelor's to the master's and now the doctorate, but we've been delivering academic education in the field of physical therapy for 40 years, which is really amazing and shows the strength and the longevity of what we do. So with your incoming cohort, if you decide to join us, we have some significant changes that are happening in our curriculum. We have made some changes through some really robust research and looking at what's best practice, what's happening out in the clinic, what is working and appropriate for accreditation standards, et cetera. And so we have a program that's 96 credits long. And within those credits, you have 30 weeks of your full experience that are clinical education experience. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a future slide, but 30 weeks of a chance to really practice your skills and be in the clinical settings with instructors that will guide you through patient care to make you feel confident and ready to be able to do it on your own. Our program is delivered through a kind of a blended format of learning. We have some semesters that are online or remote. We have some that are in person, and we'll talk about that a little bit more as well in a future slide. One of the biggest changes is that we've been teaching our curriculum with a systems-based format, which really means systems of musculoskeletal, cardiopulmonary, integumentary, and et cetera. We've kind of had a whole semester on that one system. And while that's been really helpful to learn everything all at once, we've realized as time goes on and as learning styles change that it's really more going to be more beneficial to do it in a case-based format, which is what we're moving towards. And that means you'll be learning about the systems integrated with each other, which is really how you see patients. You don't see a patient that only has a musculoskeletal injury without any other medicines for something that may be related to the GI system or other systems. So we're really making it more realistic to what clinical practice is like. So you'll have cases where you learn about the patient and you practice your skills and you learn the foundation knowledge you need and you progress it through the curriculum to become experts and ready to practice. And each case gets progressively more challenging. So you'll really be able to learn the information and apply it immediately towards a case and make it feel like it's real practice, which is different than what we've done in the past. So we're really excited to roll out this new format of learning. We continue to be leading in the realm of interprofessional practice and education at UNE. This is a strong area for us. And we know in order to get the best outcomes for your patients, you have to know how to work as a team. And as Maya mentioned in the beginning, we have a lot of different professional healthcare programs that we offer at UNE. So on the Portland campus, you will be next to rubbing elbows with, in classes with, going to lunch with, integrating your learning with students from other professions, just like you will in clinical practice. So you'll have the opportunity to do a lot of that throughout the curriculum. And lastly, we feel like, you know, you don't just want to be here learning your classes, but you want to give back to the community. And we know that's an important thing for students and for healthcare providers. And we believe that's important. So there'll be service learning opportunities for you to engage in different activities from one year to the next. on the days off and the summers and the evenings to be able to give back to the community. It could be as simple as packing bags for meals to be able to bring to people, to spending time in a homeless shelter in the community, to going into a living situation for elderly patients or elderly people and working with them on setting up their homes or doing things to make their day-to-day living more beneficial for them. So there's a lot of opportunities for service learning outside of the classroom. So here's a quick snapshot. We didn't want to fill the slide with all of the courses you're going to take, but we wanted to give you a sense of what the curriculum is like. So the first thing to note in this is that this incoming cohort that you, if you're applying and you're accepted, you'd be a part of is starting in the summer and not in the fall as we've done traditionally. The nice thing about the summer, you'll see the writing is in yellow, and that's intentional to show that that summer is delivered remotely. So you'll have three classes that will be delivered online, synchronous and asynchronous. And it's an opportunity for you to begin your graduate experience, but be able to do it in your comfort of your home environment, whether it's at home or wherever you're residing. You don't have to move to Maine, graduate. Maybe you're graduating in the spring from your undergraduate program, moving right into the doctoral program. So you're not graduating on Friday and moving to Maine on Monday. You have an opportunity to just engage in these classes, get used to what it's like to be a graduate student. It also gives you the opportunity to meet your classmates through the online classes and the activities you do. That may help you decide that when you're ready to move to Maine in the second semester of the program, so in the fall of the program, that you now have someone you may be roommates with, and that makes it easier when it's time to move and relocate if that's the case, if you're not from Maine or from the area. If you're relocating, you now may have some colleagues and some classmates that you can be roommates with. So it makes it a little bit easier in that sense too. So then if you look at the fall semester of the first year, it says five threads. If you look at the bottom of the slide, you see we are really targeting five themes throughout the curriculum. And we're starting with the fall semester as introduction to these topics. Science of movement, which is really your foundational information about what you need to know in order to be a physical therapist. Patient-client management, which is really kind of focusing on how do you interact with patients, how do you treat them, what are the ways you're going to evaluate them, what are the ways you're going to develop their treatment plan. So it's really about patient care. Then health and human development, which is looking at normal development, foundational skills to understanding the human body. Professional roles and responsibilities is thinking about you as a healthcare provider and what does it mean for you to be within the system, to be in the profession, and recognize what you need to in order to be a strong clinician. And then clinical education. This thread is really preparing you for your clinical education experiences where you get to go out into the clinic and practice the things that you've learned. So the other thing in the fall is it says CE, which is the clinical education experience that I just mentioned. You're going to go out that second semester in the program. You're going to get to go spend 2 weeks in the clinic and really start getting comfortable with being in the clinical setting, working with patients, just talking to patients and understanding that. So you get to get into that experience right away. So then you'll see the five threads through the spring of the first year. We're advancing the cases and the things that you're talking about and strengthening your skills, continuing on to the summer of your second year, and then again into the fall of your second year. The fall of your second year, you're going to finish up the semester by going out on clinical rotation for 6 weeks. So now you get another long experience to really practice the skills that you've been learning about and honing all along the way. So then the spring of your second year is yellow because it's again delivered, the five thread courses are delivered online, and then you'll be out on clinical experience for 10 weeks. And these clinical experiences are all over the United States, so there's a variety of places you could be. And then your last semester is a 12-week terminal clinical experience where you really get to the point where you feel like you are ready to do this on your own. You are an independent practitioner. Next slide, at least for me. Thank you. So some of the changes that we've made, we've tried to figure out, okay, we want to make sure we have a rhyme or a reason to these changes. this unique learning format where your first semester was remote and your sixth and seventh semester were remote or online. It's really a combination. There's a variety of reasons for this, but as I mentioned, for the first semester being online, it's really to give you a chance to slowly acclimate to graduate school and be able to get into these intense courses, but not have to move at the same time. That can be a lot of stress to do both. So it also gives you a chance to possibly find some roommates for you to move. So then you're on campus for four semesters. You have to be in person for four. And in the past, we kind of had some on campus and then you go out on clinical and then you come back and go out. Now we decided you're remote. You come here for four, then you can go for the last two and not have to be on campus. So your residential requirements are really just four semesters. I mentioned the summer semester start in that narrative and in the slide before, but it's really that transition to graduate school. Graduate school is intense. And besides it being online, we also have less credits in that semester to really get you acclimated and to make sure that we set you up for success. The program has reduced the number of semesters as a whole. The current curriculum is eight semesters and we have reduced it to seven, recognizing that we found some areas of redundancy in what we taught. Also by doing the case-based format, we were really being able to incorporate the learning into a more integrated model. And so we've been able to reduce it to seven, knowing we still have accreditation standards that require us to teach everything you need to know to be successful on your licensing exam and in your profession. So we have not reduced the knowledge. It's just that we've streamlined how we deliver this information. And as mentioned in an earlier slide, we're really excited about this case-based delivery format. You're going to get cases that help you understand why you're learning, what you're learning, how do you apply it to a patient, what is it going to look like when you get in the clinical setting long before you get into those clinical experiences. So you'll feel more confident in your skills when you actually get into the clinical setting. So I have a little black line over mine, Elise. I think it says experiential learning is what we're doing. I don't know why it's showing up on my screen with a little black bar on the top. Hopefully you can see that okay. But one of the things that we pride ourselves on at UNE in all of our programs really is that we want you to have a chance to learn through doing and through experiencing. So there's a lot of opportunities for that in the classroom and outside of the classroom. So some of these opportunities include interprofessional education and practice, which happens in the classroom, but there's also going to be a lot of opportunities for you as a student to decide you want to do more than just what's in the classroom and you want to learn. You have this opportunity to be in this wonderful Portland campus where you are rubbing elbows with students from other professions and faculty from other professions, and you want to take advantage of that. We have a lot of different events, whether it's learning sessions that you sit in or service projects that you do, team-based training that you can take in order to increase your ability to be a strong team member and make you really good at interprofessional practice. There's community-based experiences where you get to go out into the community setting and engage in learning as well as giving service to the community through some of the areas that I mentioned before, whether it's working, spending time in the homeless shelter, working to make meals for different organizations or different groups, and going into the Westbrook housing community and providing safety evaluations and other things for the community members there. One of the big things we've talked about, we have two campuses in Maine. We also have a third campus in Morocco, and that was the start of us looking at developing global health experiences and elective courses for students. So we have a variety of short-term courses, elective courses that have students go into different countries and be immersed in the culture in Morocco, Guatemala, Italy, Ireland, Iceland, and Ghana. And we're continuing to try and develop these. So, you know, if you didn't get a chance to do a semester abroad when you were undergrad and you've always wanted to do that, or you did and you want to do more of it, you'll still have these opportunities to do short-term immersion experiences that are linked to elective courses where you're going to learn about global health, cultural humility, and other things. And a lot of them are interprofessional, especially with occupational therapy. So it's nice to be able to do that too. So Clinical experience is where you really get to say, do I really understand everything I learned and am I ready to practice? There's four different times you go out, and I mentioned this earlier, but just to highlight it. First, we have, before the four that are listed here, we have what we call integrated clinical experiences, or ICE is a term you're going to hear if you come here. And those are a couple hours a week where you go out into the clinic, in a local clinic that's within driving distance, and you spend some time there just to get comfortable with being in the clinical setting, thinking about how to ask patients questions or how to interact with them and just get real introductory experience there. Then you go out and you do four different times throughout the curriculum, full-time, 40 hours per week in the clinical setting, where you're not just sitting there and watching your instructor do things, but you're doing the hands-on skills. So you have a 2-week experience in the second semester of the program. You have a 6-week experience that takes place in the fall of year two. You have a 10-week experience that's at the end of the spring of year two. And then your final semester, the summer of year three, is a full-time 12-week rotation. So in total, you'll have 13 weeks of full-time clinical experiences, which is really great. Clinicals are all over the United States. We have over 200 clinical sites that we affiliate with. That doesn't mean that at any time you have to go on a clinical, there are 200 to pick from. It just means that they are willing to take students at one or more of those four opportunities of those four points throughout the curriculum. So we have two full-time faculty that work on the clinical experiences and work closely with students to pick the sites that they want to go in, the location they want, and the setting they want. So it's a really robust process. You get to have some input. Usually you select about your top eight picks, and they help place you in the places that work with what they know your experience needs to be. It's really important that over those four experiences, you get a variety of exposure. So you don't want to have all four be in an outpatient setting. We need you to feel comfortable in all the different areas that PTs can practice. The other thing that's a possibility is you can create a brand new site. So we have over 200 sites that we currently affiliate with. Maybe there's a site that you know about that you'd really love to go to. We're always open to trying to develop new sites. There's a process for that that can be explained when you get here, but we definitely have the possibility for you to try and develop a brand new site that no student from UNE has ever gone to before. So active learning facilities, and I'm going to turn this over to Mike.
Hi. So I'm going to talk to you about a couple of the facilities that are kind of in the department or related to the department. The picture here we have is our motion analysis lab. And yes, that is a picture of the back of my head on the left side of your screen right there. The motion analysis lab, it is a lab with force plates, 3D motion capture cameras, and electromyography. Faculty do research out of this lab, and we do sometimes have opportunities for students to do research, work on faculty research projects as well. For example, I have two PT students working with me over the summer right now on a project through a funding process through our college. So they are actually not only working on the project with me and getting experience in collecting and analyzing the data, they're actually getting paid a little bit to do it as well. So at least we'll go to the next slide. So I said the motion analysis lab, it is about 1,500 square feet. If you've ever seen like how, in Hollywood, they use these little markers to kind of capture someone's motion, and they put like a visual, make someone into a dragon or the character. It's the exact same technology as that. I always say that their graphics are better, but my math is better on that point. We also have the human sensory and motor performance lab. So this is a smaller lab, but it is dedicated to measuring pain and muscle performance. We have a couple of faculty who are doing research in there and looking at like different treatment options. So how can you use something like notched stim to help someone get through a more challenging sort of a therapy session? How does someone react to pain? So if you think about pain and someone's reactions and how that might impede or inhibit, how they go through therapy. Some of the researchers there, they're actually examining those effects of pain and looking at kind of different ways to modulate or decrease that pain. Then we have our skill labs. So the skill labs are dedicated more for educational use. And this is the environment where we do a lot of our skills, a lot of our training for the students in the hands-on sort of setting. Currently, we have about 3 labs that we use at different times of the year for different courses. We have a 32-table, I believe it's 32 tables, for most of our kinesiology and musculoskeletal skills. We also have a couple of labs that are more dedicated towards neuromuscular, the neuro side, or pediatrics. So they have lower tables, different sorts of mat setups. Really what we've done here is we've taken any sort of tool that you will see in the clinic and kind of put it into these skill labs. So you get practice using those even before you get out to your first, even like your ICE experiences, your first clinical. So you can go in it with a little bit of confidence and knowing kind of what you're doing with the equipment and then how to safely manage a patient around that equipment. So this is actually, we're going to show you a short video of our simulation center. And it's just another one of the tools that we have available to us to help students get a more realistic experience and a better learning environment.
Hi, I'm Neil with the University of New England's Interprofessional Simulation and Innovation Center, known as ISIC. I'm here to give you a tour of our facility today, so let's go take a look around. The center provides a realistic, hospital-like environment where UNE students get to experience true-to-life healthcare situations. This is a place where students can learn and practice without risk to build their skills and comfort before working with real patients. This is the Skills Lab, the largest room in our facility, utilized by all of UNE's health professions programs, including nursing, physical therapy, osteopathic medicine, physician assistant, and many others. This universal setting can accommodate a variety of equipment, including high and low fidelity mannequins, as well as smaller task trainers for specific clinical skills. In the Skills Lab, students work on everything from transferring patients from a bed to a wheelchair, to CPR practice, to drawing blood. This is one of our 7 simulation rooms set up as a standard hospital room. Sim rooms can adapt to many clinical settings that might be needed in the course of a student's study. They can be set up as operating rooms, maternity and pediatric care rooms, clinical therapy spaces, and whatever else our clinical programs need to accomplish their training. As students are working in the sim room, the exercise may be recorded and controlled from the control room by a team comprised of the faculty simulation educator and an ISIC specialist. While the ISIC specialist manages the simulation technology, managing the heart and lung sounds, changing vital signs, and running our AV system, the simulation educator is able to concentrate on the student and support their learning throughout the activity. The simulation educator can directly observe the simulation and also support the student learning through coaching and guidance utilizing our direct intercom system. This is the debriefing room, where small groups of fellow learners may observe the live feed of a simulation in process, and where an exercise can be played back for the group to re-examine and discuss. This iterative process helps students to develop an objective view of their performance in a clinical exercise and an opportunity for reflection and deeper discussion. Simulation educators and learners re-examine the simulation experience to encourage participants' reflective thinking and provide feedback about their performance. The ISIC learning experience combines state-of-the-art technology with supportive mentorship between faculty and students.
Okay, so one other thing I kind of want to hit on is just the kind of community that we have at UNE. And that's comprised, obviously, of the students and the multiple students themselves. Here we have a couple of pictures of our recent graduating class, both right before the graduation. And then we have a scholarship symposium that we hold once a year where students are presenting the projects that they have. This is open to the community. We usually invite a lot of local clinical partners. We have a lot of the administration come to this event. It's usually a pretty fun evening overall. It gives a chance for the students to present in something that feels like a real, like almost a conference-like setting, but it's still on the UNE grounds. So one of the stories of student success, our recent grad, Courtney Carver, she was the class president. She also did things like she founded the DPT Sports PT Club. So we have a couple different clubs that are managed by the students themselves, along with the faculty mentor. And there's always the chance for students to expand on clubs or to start something that's more meaningful for them. She also had the Interprofessional Award Honors Distinction and was a ACAP Honor Society student. So there are a couple different opportunities for students to kind of, you know, do some things to set themselves apart from others, whether it's different sort of certifications or, you know, awards or distinctions. There's always a little way to tweak your resume or tweak your own experience with this. And it's, we're really excited that she actually accepted a seasonal position with the Indianapolis Colts and their rehabilitation team. So for student support, so here's a picture of all of our faculty. We're of course here, also here for the student support. We also have a number of different centers. So like our Student Academic Success Center, where they have tutors and professional staff. So if they're having issues with, you know, how do I take a test? You know, how do I study for a test? And learning to make yourself a better student, that's something that those professionals there can help with. Our Student Access Center is available if you, you know, need extended time or you need testing to see if you need to have any sort of accommodations for testing. We also have some other partners, career services, to help you kind of polish up a resume or build that resume throughout your time here. And of course, a health center, a graduate student affairs, and then counseling services are available for all students as well. So just some stats in the class of 2023, which is the most recent class we can report on. Our class of 2024 took their exam 5 days ago at this point. We had 97% of our students pass the MPTE. 100% of the graduates were employed within 1 year. And 95% of the students who start the DPT program end up graduating from the program. Another kind of aspect of this is after you graduate. I kind of always try to emphasize that, you know, once you get into being a student at UNE, it's really about the community. We really try to emphasize that community. We have an alumni advisory board that we've pulled some local alumni together. And they're here to help us. They give us feedback and throughout the program, they interact with the students. Some of them will act as clinical instructors for students. They will, almost all of them will show up to the student events all the time. And it's really, they see this as kind of giving back to, you know, the university and the students. And they're really interested in getting involved with the students and helping the students' careers come throughout. And some of them actually come in and teach classes for us as well. They might be adjunct instructors or lab instructors coming in. So we really try to emphasize, you know, you're a student and then you're a graduate, but you're still always kind of part of this community. And there's always someone to kind of reach back to. And I think the next slide has a prime example of this. It's Sally McCormick Tutt, who's actually a UNE graduate herself from 1993. Sorry, Sally, I had to put the year in there. But, you know, different opportunities or different things that just a handful of our alumni have done. You'll see we actually have three alumni on faculty who have stayed local in the area and have come back to, you know, these are our three full-time ones, actually. Let's just say there are more alumni who are lab assistants or part-time instructors for us as well. We have a main APTA president, Dan Delator, who they're getting ready to celebrate their 10-year reunion. He's been president for a couple of years. We have some people who've gone off to start their own clinics over time, both in Maine and Colorado, were the easy examples I threw up right there. And then a more recent graduate, you know, he's going to work for a professional football team with the 49ers. So there's all these examples you probably know that you can do with a PT degree. Trying to show that, you know, there are all sorts of things that we try to prepare you for, whether it's, you know, working to be a faculty member, either here or somewhere else, getting and carving out, you know, doing a little more teaching, getting some more teaching experience with that, or some, you know, how do you best practices in teaching, to even like the business side and trying to take those more business courses and, you know, provide resources for you guys, whether it's with our current faculty or some alumni who can talk to you about their process, what they went through. So just trying to show you kind of like some of the resources that we have.
All right, thanks, Mike. So we just wanted to add in some quick admissions points before we move on to Q&A, just in case you're planning to apply this cycle, or maybe you're just here interested in some upcoming cycles. So this is gonna be for the 24-25 cycle. So our application portal did open on June 17th. So it's open for you to apply. It's just important to note our priority deadline is November 15th, 2024. Priority meaning any applicant who applies before this deadline is guaranteed to receive some kind of decision on December 15th, 2024. And then our final deadline to keep in mind is going to be May 1st. And it is important to note that your application must be verified by this deadline. So it's important to note that it can take sometimes up to maybe like a week or two for an application to be verified. So just keep that in mind, try to plan it out, apply early if you can. And these applications must be submitted through PTCAS. So that's the Physical Therapy Centralized Application Service. Next slide. And just a really quick run through of our requirements when you do apply. So we do require you to have a bachelor's degree from a US regionally accredited institution or international equivalent prior to matriculation. So if you're still finishing up your bachelor's degree at the time of application, that's okay. You'll just let us know that on your application. In addition, you have to complete our prerequisite coursework before you matriculate. So I'm not going to go through what all those are right now. However, it's located on our website. You can go ahead and check that out. And if you have any questions about what will or will not fulfill a prerequisite coursework, please reach out to me and I'm happy to answer that for you. We must also receive all official transcripts. So even if you attended, for example, a community college for just one semester, you still need to include that transcript for us. Additionally, two letters of reference. So one must be from a licensed physical therapist and another must come from someone academic. So maybe a professor that you took a class with or an academic advisor, something along those lines, someone who can speak to, you know, your academic and professional abilities. And then lastly, we do require a minimum of 40 hours of observation with a licensed PT at the time of application. And like I said, if you have any additional questions, you can go to our website or just reach out to me. And I'm happy to help answer any questions for you.
Awesome. Thank you, Alicia. Before we officially kick it off to the Q&A section, I just want to encourage you all to either engage with us through more virtual events or on campus. We have plenty of opportunities coming up in both realms. We'll have a DPT virtual open house at the end of August, and there are also plenty of opportunities to visit us in Portland, Maine. So go ahead and you can search grad.une.edu to be taken to your personalized UNE page where all of these opportunities will kind of be available to you. Then keep an eye on your email as well for invitations to other virtual events or ways to visit us on campus. So now we want to go ahead and, oh, and then additionally, I encourage you all to follow UNE's DPT program on Instagram. Our office phone number is listed on this slide, as well as Alicia's contact information should you have any application or admissions questions. But now we'll go ahead and kick it off to the Q&A section. I know that we had some kind of come through the Q&A function on Zoom. So I'll go ahead and let Elise and Alicia take a look at those. But I kind of wanted to ask a question about student resources and how students will be supported and how they can engage with faculty members during these online semesters, both at the beginning, the first semester, and then additionally the final two when they're off on their clinical education experiences.
So Maya, I think that's a great question and aligns with what Caitlin asked in the Q&A. I didn't type that answer because I figured it's better to talk through it than to try and type all of that, Caitlin. So I'll kind of fold those in and Mike, you can fill in anything that I missed too. with the online classes, they're going to be structured in a way that there's some asynchronous work and there's some synchronous work. And we're really working on targeting that there'll be certain days you need to be available and do synchronous work. So you will be engaged with your, depending on the class, the way this faculty sets it up, but you'll be engaged with your faculty and your classmates at the same time in a Zoom type of a setting, and then break out into small groups. So we really recognize that one of the things we want with this online, with any of these online semesters, is to know that you may want to work, and we want to give you the opportunity to still be able to do that. Part of the reason for doing these online semesters was to try and decrease some of the costs that students have to incur, and that includes residential, and know that if you're home and your home environment and you had a job, maybe you could continue that job. So some of the classes will be structured that you have a couple of days where you need to do synchronous classwork. So we would say, you know what, Tuesday and Thursday, don't plan on working, because that's when you're going to need to get online. And we recognize that we're going to have students in different time zones. So you'll get online probably in a 4-hour window. And the reason I say probably is we're still trying to map out next summer really specifically, but this is the plan that from, you know, if you're on the East Coast from 12 to 4, you'll be in classes. If you're on the West Coast, it will be from 8 to 12. If you're in a different time zone in between, then you can just equate those, and you'll have the chance to interact with your faculty for those courses directly, ask questions. There'll be active learning things that are happening in those Zoom settings. It won't just be asynchronous work where you listen to a lecture that's been recorded and then you answer a discussion post. We really want it to be engaging. And then on those days where you don't have synchronous work, faculty will be available, office hours, specific times, but also individually arranged times. If you say, you know, I really have questions for you about what you talked about in class today, can we meet tomorrow? They can let you know when they're available and set up a time to meet with you over Zoom, on a phone call, whatever works best for you. So we'll have a lot of flexibility to try and meet the needs that you have for learning and for engaging and for dialoguing with your faculty, and hopefully engaging and dialoguing with your classmates, because there's a lot of studies and research that show peer learning is extremely important. So we want you to be able to feel like you connect with your classmates and you can help each other learn and go through this process. Mike, anything you want to add to that?
I think you hit most of it. I'm one of the primary ones involved in building that first anatomy course. And I know that typically makes students a little more nervous stepping into an anatomy course like that, maybe especially online. But we really are looking to make it a combination, like Sally said, of some work that you can do at your own pace. Then like, obviously you'll have some deadlines in there. So like, be prepared for a lab discussion or problem solving session on a Tuesday afternoon at a certain time. So it's going to be a mix, and that mix will allow you to, you know, kind of modify to your own schedule, but also give you some time to reach out to me or reach out to any of us if you have questions for that. We do plan on being available. That's definitely part of it. I see a question from Haley about pelvic floor PT. I tell you, we currently, and I believe we probably will continue to offer a pelvic floor workshop. Right now, that's being offered to our third-year students because it fits best with their curriculum right now. And that's offered weekend sometime in October. I can't remember exactly when to them. But that is offered to them right now at no additional cost. So we have an expert from outside coming in and giving about 15 hours worth of additional content specific to that.
Yeah, and we just to add to that, we have clinical experience opportunities that are specific to working with a therapist that engages in pelvic health clientele. So there's also the opportunity to have one of those four rotations, one of those four experiences really be focused on the pelvic health environment and patients with pelvic health issues to address. So that gives you a chance to really work on those skills more. And I just want to add, keep in mind that any DPT program is really supposed to teach you to be an entry level therapist. So we don't have the coursework in the regular curriculum that shows you advanced skills. So while we have the workshop that Mike mentioned and the opportunity for pelvic health clinical experiences, we are required to really give you a good general understanding of the PT profession. And then the hope is if you find an area of specialty, you go on and do a residency or other things to increase your knowledge in that specific area.
So just scared for more anatomy. There's a seed lexicus. So the anatomy is actually spread throughout the first year and a half of the curriculum. We'll have some base anatomy in the summer. That anatomy is going to be a combination of probably very similar to like a traditional, maybe advanced undergrad anatomy. There is some kinesiology wrapped into that as well, and some physiology wrapped into that. So the first day you get to campus, you're ready to handle the first case. But from that point, you're actually going to continue integrating that into it. So our first case, we're going to have students in the gross anatomy lab. So they're working with cadavers in like 10 to noon or something. And then after that, they'll be going to a skills lab where they're learning, you know, techniques on the hip, so range motion, maybe muscle testing on the hip. So there is anatomy integrated throughout the entire on-campus time as well as the summer.
And Mike, you sound like you went in the ocean for a little bit. So maybe Sally, can you reiterate what Mike said? It sounds anatomy was going to be over the course of like a year.
It still sounding underwater. So I think what he was answering was about the anatomy, the gross anatomy cadaver lab experiences. Yes. So one of the biggest online course in the summer of your first year is human anatomy. So you'll get the foundation information through that online course with virtual platforms and some virtual software that will help you understand that. And then when you come onto campus the next four semesters, every Thursday or almost every Thursday, you will spend time in the gross anatomy lab on the Portland campus. It's actually moving from our Biddeford campus to the Portland campus and will be there by next summer. And so you will get the chance to go into the gross anatomy lab and see the cadavers and see the different aspects of the anatomy that relate to the case that you're working on. So you'll have kind of the best of both worlds. You get the foundation virtually and have a chance to kind of understand it. And then you're going to go in and solidify that knowledge by seeing it throughout the next four semesters.
Awesome. Thank you, Sally. And I think you answered Caitlin's other question about during our time in school, do we have to specialize in a specific field? I think you shared that you're training them in a generalist PT practice.
Yes, you do not. And that's not even the desire and the goal of any entry-level program. Some programs will offer you the opportunity to get a certification or something above and beyond. And we do have some electives that give you more experience beyond. We have the interprofessional honors that gives you an honors distinction. We have the AHEC Cup Scholars, which focuses on rural healthcare and gives you a distinction and a scholar opportunity for that. So there's areas we have those within the program, but the curriculum itself is really focused on teaching you how to be an entry-level therapist that sets you up for any clinical setting that you want to practice in.
Thank you, Sally. And Mike, do you want to just say hello again, just to see if your audio is working?
Yeah, does it sound better?
Much better.
Okay. No. Okay.
So Sally, we have a couple questions about one person asked, what was the primary reason for switching to a hybrid model for the next cohort? And will this change also affect next year's tuition? Do you mind sharing a little bit more about that?
Sure. So there were a lot of things that we considered when we were looking at trying to update and modernize our curriculum to really align with best practice for teaching and learning. And then also, you know, we all went through the global pandemic, which really heightened our awareness of technology and how that can help in education. And that technology has advanced a lot since 2020 when everything changed. And so we looked at those things and said, you know, do we need to be fully in person and could we do something different? And, you know, there's student debt is high. What can we do to reduce it? It may not be through tuition necessarily, but could we reduce the residency requirement? Maybe you're not from Maine or from the Portland area even. You could be from other parts of Maine and you'd have to relocate. Could we change that so that you don't have to relocate for 7 semesters? And that those were some of the things that we thought of to try and decide how to do this. And there's some PT programs that are fully hybrid, that you do all of your didactic work online and then you come in onto their campus for an intensive hands-on training. And we thought about that option too and said, you know, we really believe it's important as a healthcare provider to get training and a lot of experience in person. But we recognize the value of learning some stuff online, some of the entry-level stuff or some of the basic stuff that you can do online and live wherever you want to live. So we kind of feel like we have the best of both worlds. We have 3 semesters where you don't have to reside in Maine if you don't want to, or you don't have to reside in the Portland area, but you can if you choose to. And we know that we can deliver the content to you as effectively, maybe even better in some ways, because we set you up with a good foundation and comfort level, because that first semester is so stressful. We can't really emphasize that enough. We know graduate school is hard. So if we can let you get your feet wet with graduate school, but stay home and have your family and your friends and the support that you're used to and the comfort of where you're living, it sets you up for better success for being a grad student. So those were some of the things that we took into consideration when thinking about, should we go hybrid or not? Should we do what we really consider it, not a true hybrid like some of the other programs, but more of a blended learning format, because we have 3 online or remote semesters and then we have the 4 in person. The tuition structure doesn't really change because the content is delivered, the same amount of content is delivered. What we see is the indirect costs that have drastically decreased because of not needing to move to Maine or live in Maine. The other thing that we recognize is now you're getting done a semester earlier than we were. So we were 8 semesters, you're getting done 7 semesters of clinical work or of classes, and now you can start practicing a whole semester sooner. And really, when we looked at it, because we switched to starting the program in the summer, you can begin your professional career 9 months sooner than what we used to do, because we used to start in the fall and go 8 semesters. Now we're starting in the summer and going 7 semesters. So you're getting a chance to start working sooner and making money. You have less living expenses. And so that part makes it much more what we think is desirable.
Anything I appreciate. Oh, yeah. Mike, feel free to share in addition to what Sally has mentioned.
I think the biggest benefit is the fact that you take the licensing exam 9 months earlier. And to me, that's 9 months of your life that's saved. And then that's 9 more months you can have to start actually, you know, getting a job and work. So.
And Sally and Mike, just speaking about being able to work and get a little bit of extra money while you're in the program, I wanted to ask, Maddie asked a question, are there opportunities in during on-campus for graduate assistant positions? I know I walk around campus and see PT students and a variety of different locations. So can you share some of those opportunities?
Yeah, so there's work study, which is in different settings other than in the department. We have some students that do work study in the library, which is kind of a nice one because you can sit there in the library and be doing your homework while you're also at the front desk answering a few questions here and there. So you kind of get to make some money while you're studying at the same time. We do offer some opportunities for graduate assistants in the program where you're helping out in classes or in our office from any 1 year to the next. It just depends on our need. They're not a set number of graduate assistant opportunities, but they're always happening. And then there are even some opportunities in our program or in others to be research assistants. Mike, do you want to talk about that part?
Yeah, so currently I have 2 PT students, as I mentioned earlier, doing a research project with me. They're actually funded through a college-wide research program to get undergraduate and graduate students now more involved in research. So that's something that's been kind of been pushed a lot more in the last couple of years. And right now the students, they're just working with me over the summer before they go on their first clinical. And they're working about, I would say on average, about 10 hours a week. So it's not a huge amount of money, but if you think about it, it is there is, you know, they are making money doing that. They're paid. And they're actually, I didn't tell you Sally this yet, but they're going to submit to go to a regional conference, some of the research. They might get on their name on a paper from it. If they continue on, that'll take a little bit longer. And it is a boost to your resume if that's something you're interested in.
Very nice. Thank you both. And we have just a few minutes left, so I want to connect with Maya to see if there were any questions that we didn't get to. I know we can always end on, what do you both love about the UNE community and the DPT community. But Maya, did you have any additional questions? I know there are some that we may not get to just with some of our time restrictions, but if you didn't get your question answered tonight, please feel free to reach out to us at gradadmissions@une.edu. Be happy to answer those and connect you with our program. But Maya, anything else we want to cover before we sort of wrap up our session this evening?
No, I don't think so. That was great. Thank you.
Awesome. And there are some great answers in the Q&A. And I know for people who are watching this back over YouTube, you may not be able to see that. But there were some questions answered about housing. We do have a graduate and professional student affairs office that works with incoming students to find available apartments in the area. But one thing that's nice is Sally and Mike have both mentioned you're going to start to get to know your cohort when you enter the program. So there'll be an opportunity to meet one another. And I know we usually have a class Facebook page or a way to even connect prior to that. And I guess Sally and Mike, one question that was asked, with transitioning to the campus in the fall, how soon should students start to look at housing opportunities? We know they don't need to immediately make that switch in the summer, but they will have to transition up to Portland by the fall. Do you have any recommendations on that?
Yeah. If you're not familiar with the Portland area, it is there are a lot of tourists in the summer. But that does mean that once fall hits, some of the housing does open up. But I would recommend you start looking in the spring if you want to move to Portland in like August to start the on-campus portion of the program. I would recommend looking in the spring before there, like start early with that, even if it's just gathering some leads of potential places you might want to live, doing that. And then maybe early summer, if you get to know some classmates, if you're looking for roommates, that'd be a good thing to get done pretty early in the summer, I think.
And let me just add that, Portland itself is a big city, but we have a lot of surrounding smaller towns that are easily commutable from. I don't know, depending on where you're from, I can say we don't have a lot of traffic. I've lived in other parts of the United States that has a lot, and we don't. So it's really feasible to pick a town. I live in a town that's 20 minutes away, and it takes me about 20 minutes to get to work. It's not that hard. So you could easily, live in an area that's not right in Portland and still be able to get into Portland easily for classes, for fun, for activities. And then you're looking at things that are a little bit easier to find or less expensive. So just keep in mind when you're looking for housing to look in our surrounding towns too.
Yeah,
I would
expand your
recommend,
search out. Yeah,
yeah,
Mike.
so like Portland, Westbrook, South Portland are the closer ones. Like Sally, you're somewhere in Gorham. I'm in Saco. That's about 20, 25 minutes
Old
away.
Orchard Beach.
Old Orchard Beach is a fun place. You can get a good winter rental as a
Yep.
student.
Yeah.
Even Biddeford, it's a little bit further. It's maybe 30 minutes, but a lot of students I know live and commute there.
And as a UNE student, you have access to both campuses. So if you do live closer to the Biddeford campus, you can use the gym facilities. There's an ice rink, pool, library, and it's right on the beach too. So it's great. And we definitely welcome you to come to campus and take a trip up to Portland. And while you're here, you can definitely check out some of the local communities to see different types of living too. Maybe you don't want to live in Portland, you want to live outside. Just with 1 minute to go, Sally and Mike, would you just quickly like to share what's your favorite thing or what do you love most about being a part of the UNE DPT community?
I love the engagement that we have with our surrounding community and how many of our alumni live in the area. and we get to interact with on a regular basis, and they love UNE so much that they want to interact with us.
A lot of my time, especially in the beginning of the semesters, is spent with students, and I really do like that. You know, it is a really good environment. It's fun to get to know everyone. It's fun to kind of break the ice. I'm actually one of the first courses, one of the first exams right now, so that's always a fun thing for it. But you know, watching the students go from being very nervous in that first little bit to really at the end looking back and, you know, I don't know why I was nervous. That wasn't that bad. You know, seeing that growth is a really cool thing.
That's awesome. All right. Well, we don't want to take any more time from anyone. We really appreciate tonight's conversation. It was a great opportunity to certainly learn and hear about some of the exciting changes and updates that are happening with our Doctor of Physical Therapy program. And I'm sure as we continue forward, we're going to be learning more and more as our faculty continue to work on designing this very innovative and unique curriculum that is new to us. So I want to thank Sally and Mike for their time this evening. Thank you so much. I want to thank Maya and Alicia for their time as well. You're more than welcome to reach out to us after tonight if you have any questions, but we hope that we'll continue this conversation and learn and share more about why UNE's DPT program might be the right place for you. And we'll follow up with the recording if you want to watch this back, and we look forward to the next time we can connect and share more with you. So thanks so much for your time and have a good evening. Thank
Bye,
you all.
Everybody.